Okay, so I think we'll go ahead and start the meeting and we'll admit folks as they join in. But we want to respect everyone's time and get started with this meeting as soon as possible. So welcome to our Thorncliffe Park virtual information session. My name is Sean Major and I'm the Senior Advisor for Community Engagement with the Ontario Line working for Metrolinx. So welcome everyone. I'd like to start off this meeting with a land acknowledgement. So let us take a moment to acknowledge that we are on the lands that have been and continue to be home to many Indigenous peoples, including the Anishinaabe, the Haudenosaunee, and the Huron-Wendat people. We are all treaty people. Many of us have come here as settlers, as immigrants, or involuntarily as part of the transatlantic slave trade in this generation or generations past. We acknowledge the historic and continued impacts of colonization and the need to work towards meaningful reconciliation with the original caretakers of this land. We acknowledge that Metrolinx operates on territories and lands covered by many treaties that affirm and value the rights of Indigenous communities, nations, and peoples. We understand the importance of working towards reconciliation with the original caretakers of this land. At Metrolinx, we will conduct business in a manner that is built on a foundation of trust, respect, and collaboration. So welcome again, everyone. I know folks are still joining, so we'll let them in as they join. Next slide, please. Welcome everyone to the Thorncliffe Park information session. I want to welcome all the residents and community members, business owners, any elected officials or staff that are joining us today, really welcome you to this meeting. We're going to have a bit of a presentation and then we'll have a Q&A. So if we could get the next slide, please, Nagina. In terms of agenda, we'll be talking about a safety moment, and then we'll do a bit of an overview. We'll talk about the elevated guideway and Don Valley works, some station renderings and features, the Overlea Boulevard preparatory works and traffic impacts on that street as well, and the operation, maintenance, and storage facility. So I just want to go over some brief meeting guidelines just to help us, and make sure that we maximize the time we have for questions and that we create a welcoming and inclusive environment. So please, help us create a respectful space for both panelists and fellow participants. We want to answer as many questions as possible. So if you can keep your questions brief, that'd be appreciated. And we'll ask for one question at a time. If you have a second question, we'll loop back to you. We'll have dedicated time for questions. So, you can note down any questions that you may have, and we'll have an opportunity at the end for your questions to be asked at the end of the presentation. And if you go to the registration page, you can also add questions to the Slido that's at the bottom of the registration page. And you can find that registration page at metrolinx.com/OntarioLine. And I also want to invite any media that may be at the event to email your questions to mediarelations@metrolinx.com. Next slide, please. So I'd like to turn it over to Lygia to introduce herself and the rest of our team members as well.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Lygia Sajjan. I am the North Civils Director at Metrolinx, overseeing the works planned in the Ontario Line North segment, with my main focus on the elevated guideways and stations. And together with the Metrolinx team, we're very excited to be presenting to you tonight the latest Ontario Line updates, focused on the activities that have started or are planned to be started in very short order in the Thorncliffe, Overlea, and Don Valley areas. A good deal of information and visual references have been prepared to support our presentation and the introduction tonight, and we really hope to give you a good overview of the current and upcoming works. Passing on to SciCat.
Thanks, Lydia. Good evening, everyone. This is Saikat Basak. I'm managing traffic issues for Ontario Line from Metrolinx. And in my part of the presentation, I'm going to be focusing on the traffic impacts on Overlea Boulevard due to the Ontario Line works and the mitigation plan that we developed in collaboration with Metrolinx. I'm passing over to Georgina.
Thank you, Saikat. Hi, everyone. My name is Gina Collymore, and I'm the Manager of Communications and Public Engagement for Connect 6. We're one of the consortiums that are helping to build the Ontario Line, and some of our work includes building out the systems, track, and maintenance facility for the Ontario Line, and we will also be operating the service once the service begins. So next, I'll pass it back over to Sean so he can get into the safety moment. Thank you.
Thanks, Gina. So it's very fitting today. We weren't quite sure. We've had weather all over the place, but at Metrolinx, we always like to start our meetings with a safety moment. And today we wanted to talk about winter emergency preparedness. And with the nasty weather out there, definitely important to think about these things. Having a supply for 3 days, including drinking water, food, snacks, baby formula, your necessary medications, warm clothing, blankets, flashlights, and extra batteries, and having a charge power bank for your phone so you can stay in touch with loved ones. And, you know, supporting, of course, those loved ones and friends that may have some accessibility needs to gather those supplies on hand as well. Next slide, please. So wanted to go through a bit of an overview of the Ontario Line. So the Ontario Line is 15.6 kilometers long. It has 15 stations, and the service is going to be as frequent as 90 seconds during rush hour. There'll be more than 220,000 more people within walking distance to transit, and about 380,000 daily boardings. And importantly, it's going to connect with 40 plus transit options, and up to 47,000 more jobs will be within 45 minutes or less on average with the new line. So I'll pass it over to Lydia to give us a bit of an overview on the north segment of the line, which we're talking about tonight.
Thanks, Sean. So to give a bit of context, the image to the right illustrates the Ontario Line elements that are planned to be constructive in the Thorncliffe Park and Flemingdon Park areas within the Don Valley and in the neighborhoods to the north and the south. The elevated guideway through Thorncliffe Park, which is illustrated in pink, that features an elevated station at Thorncliffe Park Drive, will be connected through two long span bridges, shown in yellow, constructive over the Don Valley area with the Flemingdon and Don Mills area to the north and connecting to the south to the Pape Avenue. This area is also the location for the operations and maintenance facility. Before major construction on the guideway and bridges can begin, there will be some preparatory works and advanced works that will be initiated starting now in 2024 and will progress throughout 2024 and 2025. And these works entail demolitions of buildings to make room for the maintenance and storage facility, some road reconfigurations, relocations of utilities. There will be more details to come in the next slides. And of course, the work will require a handful of long-term traffic impacts that Saikat will speak about later in the presentation. The next three slides include renderings and images that will illustrate these major guideway components that I have introduced in the slide before. So this slide, the elevated guideway slide, includes a rendering of the elevated guideway and provides an illustration of the expected appearance, aesthetics, and setting of the elevated guideway within the urban fabric. The elevated guideway spans approximately 3 kilometers and runs along Don Mills and the Overlea Boulevard between Beth Nielsen and Millwood Road, and connects three stations at Thorncliffe, Flemingdon, and Science Center. The guideway is separated from the rest of the traffic, and the trains will run along this dedicated elevated right-of-way. The design and aesthetics of the elevated profile have been inspired and guided by North American and European precedents and standards. Next slide, please. So this slide gives a little bit more information and more images to detail the guideway components. On the left, you can see a cross-section of the guideway, and it shows how the guideway has been designed to integrate drainage and utilities in trying to provide a clean and functional structure. The guideway also, through its design and profile, avoids rainwater and snowmelt from reaching onto the pedestrian areas underneath. In the middle picture, or the picture in the middle, you will see how the guideway connects with a station, and you'll see a bit more information and renderings in the slides to come. And the picture on the right is another view of the guideway from a different point of view. It gives a bit of an idea of the scale of the guideway and how it will be seen from the street. Next slide, please. This slide shows one of the most spectacular images that you will witness at the completion of the Ontario Line. It is depicting one of the bridges. As I mentioned earlier, the transfer between the tunnel along Pape Avenue and the elevated guideways in the north will be made through two large span bridges crossing the Don Valley. It's Don Valley Bridge and the West Don Bridge. The rendering gives us a good view of the Don Valley Bridge, which is illustrated in the foreground as it crosses Don Valley coming from Pave Avenue through the Minton Portal and continues north parallel to the existing Millwood Bridge, which you can see in the background, before it connects with the Overlea Boulevard. You can see how the bridge curves towards Overlea on the left side of your screen, and you can, as I said, you can see in the background the Millwood Vehicular Bridge. The second bridge, which is the West Don Bridge, will start just east of Beth Nielsen Drive and will arrive at Don Mills Road and Gateway Boulevard to connect later with the elevated guideway at Flemingdon Park Station, where then the elevated guideways continues north onto the Science Center Station. Next slide, please. To remain for a moment here in the Don Valley area, we want to introduce you to the advanced works that you will notice right in the spring of 2024. So between spring 2024 and spring 2025, north of the DVP, the work on the Ontario Line will focus on the construction of a new sewer that will be tunneled, a construction of a retaining wall that will be built to provide structural support to the southbound DVP lanes. And in addition to that, there will be a construction of a new access road. What's interesting about the construction in this area is the methodology of construction for the sewer, which is a micro-tunneling methodology, which has been selected to ensure that there is less disruption above ground. It assumes a small tunneling boring machine that will be required to install the sewer without the need for an open excavation. So as I was mentioning, you will be able to see some work in the Don Valley area starting this spring. Moving on to the next slide. We wanted to add a couple more images to describe the station. So on the left, you can see a depiction of what a station interior could look like. It's important to note that as the design moves forward and and the project progresses, some of those images and the interiors may look different than the renderings. It's also very important to notice that the stations will be fully accessible and built in compliance with the Accessibility for Ontarians with Disabilities Act. And as a Toronto first, we'll also introduce platform edge doors on Ontario Line that have the intent to make the stations more comfortable and safer. And, you know, for example, the doors will prevent people falling onto the tracks by accident. On the right side of the image, it's an example of what an outside, like an exterior look of the station could look like. You can see that the design is based on a transparency principle such that, you know, there is a connection between the outdoor and the indoor, as well as to ensure wayfinding. Under the guideway, the lighting will illuminate the space to support a safer experience. Moving on to the next slide. It's the next slide. We'll focus on the preparatory works as they relate to the Overlea Boulevard and the Thorncliffe area. As I was mentioning before we start work constructing the guideway and stations or the maintenance and storage facility, there is a need for a preparation of the sites to receive this construction. And that preparation entails moving utilities or other infrastructure out of the way. So the works that can be expected are utilities relocations, tree removals, some demolitions of properties, road realignments, and that is for the purpose of making room for the guideway on the north side of Overlea, which will be the area where the future elevated guideway will be installed. So work has begun in the fall of 2023 and will continue throughout 2024 until late 2025 as preparatory works. And moving beyond 2025, you will expect the construction of the major construction of the major elements of the guideway. So moving on to the next slide. We tried with this slide to bring together in one snapshot all those preparatory works along Overlea Boulevard and outline them on a timeline. So as I was mentioning, in 2023, early 2023, there were tree removals that have been started in February. That were followed with some demolitions at 36 Overlea Boulevard, followed by the renovation of the mosque. The works are undergoing and the expected completion is later in 2024. You may have also seen some demolitions that have happened or will still happen at 10 Overlea Boulevard, the March of Dimes building, and 36 Overlea Boulevard. From February 2024 to August 2025, so there will be additional tree removals, then utility relocations, mainly storm and sanitary infrastructure, followed by realignment of the Overlea Boulevard, which means some road lanes relocation, as well as removing the road median. There will be works to extend the Leaside Park Drive, reconfigure the Bannigan Drive, and there will be a closure of the Thorncliffe Park Drive north of Overlea Boulevard. This is all to enable the construction of the major elements of the guideway foundations, pillars and the elevated guideways and the stations, and that will start in 2025, and as I was mentioning, will go all the way to the completion completion of Ontario Line in 2030. So I believe this is the end of the overall presentation of, you know, the infrastructure to be expected in the area, as well as the preparatory and advanced works. And moving on, SICAD will speak to some of the traffic impacts. SICAD, handing it over to you.
Thanks, Lydia. Thank you. And again, thanks, Navina. As Lizia mentioned, there'd be some preparatory works related to utility location and road realignment would be required to facilitate the guideway construction for Ontario Line on north side of Overly Boulevard. And related to all these constructions, Metrolinx has been working collaboratively with the City of Toronto for over the last year or so to identify a plan and approach to coordinate and mitigate traffic impacts. And to get the approval on the road closures, we need city approval, and city staffs are currently working on a report and expected to report on these long-term temporary road closures near the Thorncliffe Park Station. And that report is expected to go to the June Executive Committee and City Council meeting. And from this particular meeting, we are going to be sharing the feedback from you with the city so that they can incorporate your comments into their staff report to the council. And that report in general going to include the approval of lane closures for Overly Boulevard, roughly between Milud Road and just a little bit east of Thorncliffe Park Drive, Westlake. So we are going to look into the details of the impacts and mitigation in the next two slides. So this particular slide shows the traffic impacts from all the preparatory works, which we are calling advanced work. And these would be generally starting from spring pretty soon now and up to summer of 2025 for about 18 months. And if you look into this graphic, you'll see that we are going to maintain sidewalks on pedestrian pathways on both sides of the roadways all the time during the construction. There might be some realignment of the pedestrian pathways, but both sides pedestrian pathways would be maintained all the time. The impact would mostly be in terms of traffic lanes and realignment of those lanes as the construction progresses. And as you also can see, and there are HOV lanes, as you know, where buses, TTC buses currently operate, that would be removed. And generally, the lanes are going to be moved a little bit farther south. And to facilitate the road alignment, we would need to remove the median or narrow the median at some points. And that would be generally between Milud Road and up to 200 meters east of Thorncliffe Park Drive. So that's all the impacts that we are expecting for the next 18 months. And now let's see what would happen after that advanced work. So this is essentially the configuration of Overly Boulevard that you will see likely in fall 2025, in about 18 months from now. So at that point, the road would be back to four lanes, like with the current configuration that we see on Overly Boulevard right now. And there would be a few other improvements and also some changes to the roadway network as is shown here. So we have been in Metrolinx, we have been working with the city to facilitate cycle tracks on Overly Boulevard as planned by the city. And as part of the advanced work towards the end of it, we are going to be including the cycle track on the south side between Milud Road and Leaside Park Drive. And the rest of the cycle tracks on both sides up to Thorncliffe Park Drive would be added later. And there are a few other significant changes that you can see on the cross streets and in the adjacent area are going to be done as well. On the top right corner, you can see that maintenance and storage facility for Ontario Line are going to be constructed in that area. And to facilitate that construction, we would need to close Thorncliffe Park Drive at that point, and a part of Bennigan Drive would need to be closed at that point as well. And to accommodate the traffic connection from Bennigan Drive with Overly Boulevard, there would be a new street constructed connecting between Bennigan Drive and Overly Boulevard, which is could be called Leaside Park Drive extension. So that road would be in place by that time. And there would be a few other cycling improvements at Millwood and Overly intersection that has been requested by the city. And as part of the advanced work construction, we are going to be accommodating all of that. So those are all the traffic impacts and mitigation plan. And with that, I'm going to be passing over to Georgina to talk on the Ontario Line maintenance and storage facility related impacts.
Thank you, Saikat. In November of 2022, ConnectSix was awarded one of the many contracts to build the Ontario Line. ConnectSix is made up of five different organizations: Plenary Americas, Hitachi Rail, Rebuild, NGE, and TransDev. Each of these organizations is bringing a very unique skill set to deliver this very transformative project. As part of the project and part of our contract, it's known as the ROSM contract, and what it includes is the rolling stock, signaling, operations, and maintenance of the Ontario Line. So some of what the ConnectSix will deliver includes designing and building the tracks. We will also be building out the signaling systems when some of the other consortiums are completing their work. And we'll also be creating and building the OMSF, which is the operations, storage, and maintenance facility. Afterwards, once the Ontario Line does come into operation, we'll be operating and maintaining the fleet for the next 30 years. Next slide, please. So like I said, the operations, maintenance, and storage facility, or commonly known as referred to as the OMSF, is essentially the central location of the Ontario Line train and storage and maintenance facility. It's going to be located near Thorncliffe and Leamington Park, and it will oversee, like I said, the operations of the line, signaling and communications, maintenance, line security, safety, performance management, and again, track and train maintenance. It will also house the administrative and operations offices. And as you can see in the image here, this is an early rendering of what the facility may look like. Again, it's a work in progress and definitely subject to change. Next slide, please. One of the other pieces of this project that we will be delivering is the trains. So the Ontario Line will feature four-car trains that are electric and expandable. As part of the trains that we're building for the team, our team is very experienced in building trains and has a lot of expertise in this. We have systems and trains around the world, including everywhere from Milan, Rome, Copenhagen, Peru, and even in Honolulu. The technology is very innovative, and it will, like I said, it'll include driverless trains and new technology so that the trains can speak to each other so that they can move efficiently. Next slide, please. So this slide just gives a very high level overview of what is happening in the coming years. As you can see, we don't have a lot of work from our team happening for quite a few months, even years. We're currently just doing early site preparation for the OMSF, and the construction of the OMSF won't begin until later next year. Following that, we have quite a few years later where we'll have the delivery of the first train, and completion of the OMSF is expected in late 2029. Next slide, please. This slide really just provides a map and gives a better overview or look at where the OMSF is in relation to the community and the major arteries into and out of the community. As you can see, the OMSF is kind of set back. It's away from the main road, which is Overlea Boulevard, and is just behind or away from the community, in that it's set back near the behind the valley. So there are trees and quite a bit of greenery that separates it from the main area. The right below the tracks that you'll see on the screen are some of the storage tracks. These tracks are where we will store the trains and have them cleaned and washed. But for the most part, most of the work and the maintenance of the vehicles will happen in the OMSF, which is set further back from the road. And next slide, please. Here we just have some renderings that were released a few weeks ago. Again, these are works in progress and are subject to change, but they give a better idea of what the OMSF will look like, how set back they are from the main area, and how the views look facing different directions. You can see that the one below is the front view of the facility from Beth Nielsen Drive. The one above is kind of the rear, where you can see the hydro corridor or the valley below. Next slide, please. And here we have just a few images of what the trains could look like and some of the innovative new technology that we're working with to deliver these trains. Mentioned earlier were the platform screen doors, which are a new feature that are going to be on these trains. And you can see that in the bottom left corner. The bottom right corner has a view of the interior of the train. As you can see, the interior, you can walk directly through it, similar to line one. And of course, in the top right corner is what we call a viewing window. So when the train is complete and we're in service, there is large windows that residents and users of the service can definitely look out of the window and see the city behind it. So again, these are early renderings and they definitely are subject to change, but we're committed to working with Metrolinx to bring these renderings to the community when they're available. Thank you. I'm going to pass it back to Sean.
Thanks, Gina. So I just want to return back to slide number 17. Apologies, there was a bit of a technical blip there, but I want to make sure that we spend some time on slide number 17. If we can go to that, please. As you, I'm sure, are aware out in the community, at 20 Overlea Boulevard, we need to create some space for the operations, maintenance, and storage facility that we need to relocate to 2 and 4 Thorncliffe Park Drive. So the Islamic Society of Toronto, or IST, will move into 20 Overlea along with other tenants as part of a business hub. And so you've probably already seen some of the work happening on the building right there on Overlea. And, you know, just wanted to really share and showcase this slide. And I know there was also a question raised regarding this site, and definitely want to address that question. If we can go back to the question slide, Gina. So we will be opening up to questions shortly, and we will take questions from both folks speaking up in this meeting. And if you prefer, you can also go to our Slido feature to put in your questions through text. So I'll speak to that in a moment. But to speak through the system, what you'll do if you're on your computer is you'll hit the raise hand button, and that will put you in the queue. So everyone will have a turn, and we'll make sure that you know, everyone has a chance to ask one question, and then to loop back if we can. And then I'll enable your microphone, and I'll call on you to speak. And then what you'll need to do is just unmute yourself. So you'll see the mic button, and just make sure that it doesn't have a cross through it. If you're on a phone, you can use the hand button again to raise your hand. That'll put you in a queue so that we can get to folks in order. And again, I'll call on folks to unmute yourself by clicking the microphone icon at the bottom of the screen so that you can speak. And next slide, please. So another option, if you prefer to speak through text or you're more comfortable that way, certainly please use our Slido feature. If you're joining us on your computer, you can use your smartphone to scan this QR code. And you can also go to this on your phone by visiting slido.com and putting in the code 3104306. So both ways, we're open to questions and would love to hear your thoughts and comments and your questions. So I will open it up and start off the questions. And if we can just leave it on the Slido slide so folks can go into that for now. So the first question that I have, I'm going to actually speak to a question that came through Slido originally. The question was, when will the Thorncliffe Park Masjid be demolished or destroyed? Could we please speak to the demolition? And I'll call on, is there someone from that could speak to this question? Okay, I will ask John if you can speak to this question.
We'll have to get you the exact date. I know the intention is to have the IST relocated before Thorncliffe Park Drive is closed and demolition work begins on the buildings that along Thorncliffe Park Drive that we're planning on taking. So we'll get that information to you shortly. I hope we can have it before the end of the meeting.
Thanks, John. So we will now go over to people joining by voice. So I'm going to open it up for Amir to unmute yourself and ask your question, please.
Yeah, Sean, that was my question, the one you just asked. And I love seeing how stumped everyone was. Just unfortunate no one has an answer for that question, because that is a concern for our community. Part of your consultation, we raise that often. You guys heard it often, and it's unfortunate you have this great presentation with all the information, but no one can talk to when our mosque, a place of worship, is going to be destroyed. So I hope we get an answer by the end of the night.
Yeah, Mayor, and hi. Good to see you online. We will get that response and apologies, because we know, you know, we're aware of many of the details. We didn't have a detailed demolition plan, and we should have. So that is our miss, and we'll get that information to you.
Thank you, John.
Thank you, Amir. Okay, now I will turn it to Andrew. So if you can unmute yourself and ask your question.
Can I just jump in? Apologies, I just got notification. The IST is demolishing their own facility. They have the date and we'll get that for you.
Thanks, John. So we will turn it to Andrew, please. Go ahead and unmute yourself.
Yeah. All right. Well, I just wanted to say hi. I think Andrew's going to ask.
How are the birdies? How are the little people?
Good.
What are they doing?
What's Bryn going? Is actually.
Sorry, is there a question that you have, Andrew?
Oh, hold on.
Oh yes. I was just wondering if there's any going to be any demolition on the north side of Bannigan, where there currently is not.
We'll call you this weekend.
Okay, so maybe I'll ask Saikat if you can speak to that.
Hi.
Okay, if we can please go to, this is slide, I believe, 14, sorry, 15. That's essentially shows all the property demolition and where the, okay, let's go to the previous one. That's slide 14, 15. Again. I know Nagina is putting it in, and I'm looking into my other screen on that particular slide. So essentially, as you have seen from my presentation, we are gonna be for the Ontario Line maintenance and storage facility work, almost like half of the Bennington Drive from the Thorncliffe Park Drive, that would need to be closed up. But there is no demolition of property further north or west of it. To make the connection from Bennington Drive to Overly Boulevard, as I mentioned earlier, that the new Leaside Park Drive extension are going to be making, facilitating that connection. Hope I answered your question.
Thanks, Saikat, for that. And we might have you on deck for another question coming from our Slido feature. So the question is, how are the bus routes 25, 181 going to be affected by the road work and reconfigurations?
Thanks, and thanks for that question. Generally, there wouldn't be any impact to the existing bus routes. If you could just go back to slide 20. Please stay there for a sec. The one previous to it. Yeah, thank you. So this essentially shows the exact impacts during the preparatory works for the next 18 months. And as I mentioned, there wouldn't be any impact in terms of bus routing to all the routes that you have mentioned in your question. And the bus stops that would be like in place during these 18 months that are shown in this graphic here. And I believe there is that there is no changes to the Overly Boulevard bus stops, but there are two stops along the Milud road that would be moved from the southbound stops from the first side. It would be moved to the north side of Overly Boulevard along Milud, and then for the northbound route, the near side stop is going to be replaced by a far side stop over at the northeast corner of Milud and Overly. Hope that answered your question. Thank you.
Thank you, Saikat. So now I'm going to go again to voice, and after that, we will go back to the Slido feature. So Monica, if you can please unmute your mic and go ahead.
Actually should go back to that slide because it was about the buses. Thank you for the answer that you gave. That was great. But I noticed something. There are a lot of people that transfer to the 56, which is that bus stop just south of the, or just, what is that? East, southeast of, yeah. So just southeast of Overly on Millwood, there was a bus stop. And that's where everybody who needs to transfer to the 56 going southbound to the Donlin station would transfer from any 25, 100 or thing. So where is that going to happen now? Because if they get off up at the one that's now at Millwood and Overly on the north side, they're going to have to walk the entire block up to Leaside Park and Overly, because the bus stop that is just across the street is only for the 88.
Okay, thank you, Monica. Saikat, could you speak to that question, please?
Thanks, Monica, for that question. And this is a great one. Unfortunately, I don't have the detail right at this point, but we are going to be coordinating with TTC to get your answer and then get back to you as soon as possible. So we are going to get your contact detail, Monica, and we're going to be getting back to you soon. And just to rephrase the question so that I understand it correctly, you want to understand how the Milwood Road bus 56, if someone is going southbound, how you are going to be connecting with the 25 bus, which is going farther east. Did I understand that correctly? Monica?
Sorry, one moment. I just need to enable her mic.
Sure.
Go ahead, Monica.
Awesome. Thank you. Sorry about that. Screaming at the screen.
My apologies.
No, that is completely incorrect.
Okay.
For anybody coming southbound on the 25, the 100, or the 81, it goes to Overlee and Millwood, turns left, and then goes to Pape Station. That stop is where they would catch the 56 if they wanted to go to Donlands instead. So I'm just wondering what they're going to be doing with that, especially since I don't believe Donlands is accessible yet. So we can't do the Pape Station subway to the Donlands station.
Okay, so I got it. So the buses that are coming from Milwood and that's going, how you are going to be going to the Donlands station bus, that's we need to make sure and make sure that these two are going to be connected. I'll get that answer for you, Monica.
Thanks, Saikat. And just so folks know, we will also keep our Slido feature open on the website after this meeting. And for questions that we're not able to address during the meeting, we will put those questions into the Slido so that you have the answers there as well. And next we have a question from Slido again. It asks, what level of noise can we expect from the trains as well as from the maintenance facility? And I'll ask John to speak to this question, please.
Yeah, so I'm just going to introduce the topic, speak at a high level, and then I'd like to pass it on to my colleague David King to provide you details about the noise impacts of the new automated trains and the OMSF site, which most of the noise would probably come out of the storage yard, but David will give you details. So in general, you know, we have requirements around noise levels for the Ontario line once it's in service, but there are a lot of benefits that are built into both the design of the elevated guideways and the design of these electric automated vehicles that make up our train sets. We will have areas with noise barriers on the elevated guideway close to very sensitive receptors. These are buildings that are, you know, a few meters, you know, 6 to 12 meters from the guideway edge. And even though these noise barriers are not, you know, in most cases not required by legislation, they're being provided as added benefit to a few neighbors who will be most impacted by proximity to the Ontario line. So as for the details, David, can you take it away?
Yeah, sure. Thanks, John. So great question. Thank you. I would say the first thing to consider is that the Ontario line technology is state of the art. It is new, and there has been a lot of work done in terms of transit building to mitigate noise and vibrations. So, you know, from the local context, we know how loud, you know, the TTC line 1 or line 2 is. We know what it's like living next to a streetcar line, the way the wheels squeal. And if you, you know, live on line 2, you feel it in your basement. But the Ontario line simply just will not be built to that standard. The way the track is going to be fixed to the guideway prevents a lot of the noise and vibrations. The way automated trains operate, they brake very smoothly, they accelerate very smoothly, and they don't wear their wheels in a way that creates that screeching. The way they handle curves, same way. So, you know, the technology of 2024 here is really going to you know, mitigate a lot of the noise that you know from experience. So overall, we don't expect a lot of noise, but like John said, there's a very comprehensive noise and vibration monitoring plan. As for the yard and the operations facility, closest to Thorncliffe, it's just stabling tracks. So trains just sit there and they park and they drive in and out as required. So that'll be the same type of noise as just day-to-day operations. So we're not expecting a lot. Where the trains are actually worked on will be in the OMSF building. So if you refer to that other slide, that was set well back from Thorncliffe in the light industrial area up near Beth Nielsen there. And the work happens inside a building. So, you know, a lot of the noise will be mitigated. You know, it'd have to get through a whole building. So inside the yard, again, trains move very slowly, 15 kilometers an hour. So, you know, we are not expecting a lot of noise for you guys. I hope that answered your question.
Thanks, that's great. So now we will move on to our next person on voice. So that's Ahmed. If you can unmute and ask your question, please.
Hi, my name is Ahmed Ilsaraf. I'm a Thorncliffe Park resident and also an architectural interior urban designer by background as well as development consultant. I do have two questions, and I'll try to keep them as simple, word them as simply as possible.
One. So I'm going to ask you, sorry, Ahmed, I'm going to ask you to just, if you can keep it to one question, just because we have a number of questions. But if you can hold that question, we'll get to it at the end if possible.
Okay. Thanks. So the question, no problem. The question would be, in terms of the business center that you mentioned is now being a part of the masjid to replace the area impacted, but the train yard and the maintenance and storage facility. How much of that is this something that's being done privately between IST and Metrolinx, or is this something that the public's going to be included in terms of how it, or at least some kind of engagement or feedback in terms of how it functions? Because I'm personally having trouble finding, and maybe this is on me here, I'm just not looking in the right place, finding plans or to get an understanding of how this will function to replace the space or to mitigate what's really happening in that area. Like how would it function? Where are these business centers or hubs supposed to go into that building? Just more clarity on that would be great.
I'll take this question. But we'll need to get back to you with details because, of course, there are floor plans that outline the where the various programmatic elements are within the IST. But that is their facility, and in the end, they're the owners of the site and building, and they are the clients who determine what will go into the building. But I do know that there is a community-based, you know, business hub planned for the facility. And I think what would be best is to reach out directly to the IST to get a sense of what the programming is and how you can become more involved.
Okay, great. Thanks, John. So we have another question from Slido. What additional infrastructure, hospital, school, community center, medical buildings will you put in place within the building of six new high rises? Why add more density to an already dense and underserved community? So I will also note that this relates to, I believe, the Infrastructure Ontario transit-oriented communities that is coming up. And I want to take this moment to remind folks, if you have the opportunity, there is a virtual meeting on February 29th and in-person meeting on March 7th. You can find out more details about this transit-oriented communities by going to www.engageio.ca for some of the meeting details. So this question would be something that Infrastructure Ontario would be focused on primarily And, you know, they would be able to answer more details of those questions. And then I want to turn over to Lucas to ask your question. If you can unmute yourself and ask the question, please. Lucas, if you can please open your mic. Okay, it looks to not be working. So I will go to Archie next. And if you can unmute yourself and go ahead and ask your question. Okay, seems like we're having some audio issues, no problem. So we'll switch over to Slido. And the next question from Slido is, how tall will the elevated guideway be? And I will turn that over to John for that question.
Okay, and thank you for that question. So the elevated guideway, is going to be running at a elevation of between 5.9 and 7.5 meters above the finished grade along Overly Boulevard. And the reason for the variation is because Overly Boulevard is not a completely flat topography. And we come off the Don Valley crossing at the over Millwood at a very high height, and there's a gentle slope to the new Thorncliffe Park Station, because once the guideway connects to Thorncliffe Park Station, and then on the east side of Thorncliffe Park Station, the guideway then veers to the north before the Costco site and goes under the hydro lines in the Honey Corridor. So the heights of the guideway are very carefully calibrated, and they're also calibrated to ensure smooth ride for passengers on the trains. But you can expect a 5.9 meter minimum clearance, but in general, it's between 6.4 and 7.5 meters.
Thanks, John. And I know folks may have to drop off to go to other obligations. We definitely like to keep our meetings on time, so we understand if you do have to drop off. But we know that there's some questions still coming in from folks and want to give an opportunity for as many questions as we can. So we'll stay on this meeting for another 15 minutes, or if the questions are done before that, we can certainly log off, but want to give some more opportunities for folks. And I want to go to Sheila Hickey and open the mic for you. And if you can unmute, please, and ask your question. Okay, Sheila, if you can click the unmute button, so click the mic and make sure it's not crossed to unmute. In the meantime, while we're working. Turn that to David or Gina to speak around the operational hours.
Yeah, I can start, Gina, and you can jump in if I miss anything. Operationally, we expect the system to run similar to what you guys would expect from the TTC today. So your early morning kind of 5:30, 6 a.m. to about 1:30, give or take. Obviously, operational needs will be reviewed as things go. You're going to be looking at demand patterns, stuff like that. And, you know, if there are maintenance closures, those kind of things are going to happen over the life cycle of a transit line. But I would expect that, you know, from day to day, it's going to be, you know, congruent with what you see with the TTC. Gina, would you add anything?
No, David, I think you've covered it. I think just relaying it back to what the GTC already does is probably definitely something similar to what we would do as well.
Yeah, and the idea being like we are we interface with, this is an integrated transit network. We have interchange stations with the TTC. Like keeping it all on one page makes the most sense, right? People don't want to be stranded from one to the other. So good question, though. Thank you.
Thank you, Gina and David. So I'm going to try. I know we've had some technical difficulties, but voice again. So I have Hasna. Sorry if I've said your name incorrectly. Can you please unmute your mic and ask your question? Okay, so apologies. Again, if you want to, if we can go back one slide, Nagina, just to show folks what they need to do. Again, you'll need to hit the mic button. You'll see that button and make sure that there's not a cross through it to unmute. Or if you're on your phone, you'll need to hit the mic button to make sure that there's not a cross through it. So apologies about those difficulties. But in the meantime, we will go to our next Slido question, which is, when is the new bridge construction starting that will go over the Don Valley Parkway parallel to the existing Leaside Bridge? So that's how we had that in the presentation. Ali, could you take on this question, please?
Yes, sure. So that bridge over the Don Valley Parkway is expected to start September to August, August to September of this year, 2024. But that's going to be the start of the preparation work, construction of access roads and soil stability at Edmonton Portal Place, and also foundation work. So that's the start of construction. You know, when the contractor is expected to mobilize and prepare for the construction of the bridges.
Thanks, Ali. So we'll go to, I'm going to try this once more. We'll go to Amir and see if you are able to ask your question. There we go. Go ahead, Amir.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thanks. So I just, to John's answer, did he say we need to find out from IST? And if so, that doesn't make sense because IST said Metrolinx expropriated the mosque and that's why they were forced to give it up. So why would we need to ask them?
No, IST is they're the ones who are responsible for demolishing their facility. And so that is why they have the timing.
But purchased it, no?
Yeah, but we purchased the land, absolutely. But IST is responsible for managing their own construction.
I appreciate your answer. They're a bunch of villagers, and they're not good at communicating what's going on to anyone. That's why Ahmed asked his question earlier.
I'm just going to jump in. We will try to follow up on this question. I just want to make sure that we're keeping...
It's a huge concern, Sean. It's a huge concern for the entire community. So I just want to say one thing. Can we rely on Metrolinx to get us that information as opposed to people that are giving misinformation, even about what they're dealing with or what deals they've made with Metrolinx?
We're in the dark. Absolutely. We have your questions, and Sean and his team will get you the information you want or you're asking for from the IST, and we'll verify it with our own project delivery teams because, of course, we have to schedule their works. But we'll get that to you from them just so that you have a clear communication because this is important because it is part of the overall Ontario Line works in the area. So we'll talk to them.
Okay. Thanks, John, for that. And we will certainly follow up. Just so folks are aware too, with your registration, we will have your email addresses. So we will make sure we reach out through email to any questions that we need to follow up with. And we've been keeping note of that. The next question comes through Slido. Will the Don Valley Trail be completely closed with the construction of the Overlee Bridge? And I believe that to clarify this question, the construction of the bridge will be a bridge that's parallel to the overlay bridge. So it'll be a separate bridge. And I'll ask Ali to answer that, please.
Yes, if that refers to the Don Valley Bridge, then yes, when the construction starts in August or September of this year, I'm also assuming that by the trail, so it's a lower Don trail. So that lower Don trail is going to be realigned during the construction. It's like at the beginning of the construction, it's going to be accessible, but you know, there's going to be flagging to allow the use of that trail. But there's also going to be a realignment halfway through the construction. There's also a mountain bike trail. If you're referring to that one, that's going to be completely blocked starting August of this year for several years, but it's going to be restored at the end of the construction.
Great, thank you for that. So now I'm going to go to our folks on voice here and go to Bella, who's been waiting patiently. Bella, could you ask your question? You'll need to open your mic first.
Hello?
Yes, we can hear you, Bella. Go ahead with your question.
Oh, okay. Hi, assalamu alaikum. I'm just going to introduce myself to the community. So, Marunam Habiba Desaita. So I go by Bella when I work professionally, especially in development. So I heard the question about the mosque. I actually wanted to bring up why no one's mentioned the community benefits agreement. And I was assuming that there was something that was happening with it already. So what kind of benefits are going to be provided to the community, or what has Metrolinx thought about giving the community? And I do have a meeting with Ahmed on Tuesday, so I'm going to learn more about what the community is looking for. And I'm going to get back to Amir about the question for the mosque as well. So I will try to touch base with Metrolinx and with the mosque directly and find out exactly what's going on, because I've received a lot of complaints. I'm going to be honest. I see that there's some type of hostility that's going on as well. So there needs to be openness and transparency. And I do believe that this project is very good for our community. This project is great for Toronto. It's great for Ontario. And I just think if everyone can get on the same page, we can all work together and we're going to have a really beautiful future for ourselves and our children.
So, thank you, Bella. Thank you, Bella, for your comments and for your question as well. And would also invite folks, if they wish to visit us in our community office. We're located in the East York Town Center besides the LCBO, and we're there Monday through Friday. We have had recently a job fair that was well attended by about 1,300 people. So that was held at the Cypriot Center in January. And to speak a little bit to the pillars of the community benefits, I'll turn the question over to John.
Okay. And so, Bella, I would, you know, if you want more detail, because we have a community office right at the East York Town Center, I think we could always set up a single topic meeting and bring in our team that is managing the community benefits program for Metrolinx, if you'd like to have a sort of a more focused meeting. But to get to the community benefits and supports programs that Metrolinx is implementing across our network, they could fall into four pillars. Pillar one, which is employment opportunities, and that talks about hiring targets for local communities and equity seeking groups. We have pillar two, local business supports, something that Sean's team takes very seriously, and we work with our contractors to make sure that wherever possible they procure goods or services from local businesses. We have pillar three, which is public realm improvements. And this is a very key one. It's something we've been that we've been working on since for the last couple of years, that we're going to be sharing more information. We're going to want some feedback, but that has been one of the, that has probably been the, you know, the benefit that we've been working on the longest. But, you know, the employment opportunities and local business supports are absolutely key. And we understand that those are probably the most, those are the benefits of most interest to the Thorncliffe Park and Flemington Park communities. And then pillar four is called community improvement supports. And that's about, you know, that deals with, you know, making sure that we work with communities to sort of help manage the construction process and what, you know, impacts it may have on the communities where we're doing our work. But as I say, we'd be glad to have a, you know, Bella, if you'd like it, we'd be glad to set up a meeting in our community office so we can hear more of your concerns in detail so we can start to address them.
Definitely, John. Thanks for saying that. And Bella, we'll make sure we reach out to you on that front. I want to go to SciCat with the next question from Slido. With the elevated guideway, how much road space or vehicle lanes could we lose?
Thanks. As I mentioned, Nagina, if you could please go to slide number 20. The one previous to it. Thank you. So as I explained when I was speaking on this slide, that during these 18 months duration, starting from spring this year up to summer, end of summer 2025, there would be one vehicle lane maintained between Milud to just east of Thorncliffe Park Drive along Overley. So that's the major impact in terms of lane closure. However, in the, like after all the preparatory works are completed, Nagina, if you could please go to the next slide. So this is going to be the configuration after the preparatory works are completed in summer 2025. At that point, road would be back to two traffic lanes per direction, HOV lane included. The only change that you will see, that the median that we see in between Milud and Leaside Park Drive, that would be gone. And the median between Leaside Park Drive and Thorncliffe Park Drive, that would be narrowed a bit. And on top of that, there would be some improvements. As I mentioned, that there would be a bike lane on ultimately on the both sides of Overley Boulevard between Milud and Thorncliffe Park Drive. But after the preparatory works are completed in summer of 2025, at that time, you will see the bike lanes installed on the south side between Milud Park Drive and Leaside Park, Milud Drive. And Leaside Park Drive. And as I mentioned previously, all these are from the requests of the city, I mean, in terms of the bike lanes that we are accommodating as part of the Metrolinx construction. Hope that answers your question.
Thanks, SciCat. So I do want to address a question that was coming up on Slido as well. There was a question around when we can expect the construction, the project completion. It said in the deck late 2020s. And to clarify, we're looking at 2031. Of course, recognizing, you know, it is a complex contract construction project, but the goal is 2031 for the project to be completed. And I will do one more question from Slido, and I think that'll be our last question for the night. And we will also connect with folks that we maybe didn't get to either through Slido or through voice to follow up. So the question is, will the Salvation Army building at the corner of Overley and Millwood be affected? And I'll turn that to John for this final question tonight.
Okay, so this is a very good question. And we are actually We have been communicating and meeting with the Salvation Army quite regularly. And, you know, we are very aware of their concerns because they do great work in this community and communities across Canada. And so what we do not want to do is negatively impact their operations and programs at their headquarters. So we have talked about, you know, both construction impacts and operation impacts on the building. So in terms of construction impacts, the biggest concern was ensuring that the Salvation Army has continuous access to their site throughout construction, both for cars and pedestrians. And so we've assured them that that will be the case. There will be a detailed construction management plan developed that, you know, will look at, especially when we get into the phases where the elevated guideway is being built in this area, making sure that we never interrupt their site access. There were concerns about the impacts of noise and vibration. We talked about that earlier, and we talked about areas where there'll be localized noise barriers on the elevated guideways. And in recognition of the proximity to the building, this is going to be one of those areas. So, you know, they have put together a substantial list of areas that of concern, and we are addressing them directly. I hope I answered that question well.
Yes, you did. Thank you, John, for that. So just noticed that we've borrowed 17 minutes of your night, and really glad that we could get through as many questions as possible with folks. If you didn't get your question answered, we'll either follow up with folks that we mentioned we'll follow up with, and we'll be connecting via email. But you can also reach out to us on email. We have a 24/7 hotline that you can call, which is listed here. You'll find this all on our website, metrolinx.com/OntarioLine. And you can sign up for our newsletter there as well. And of course, our team is in your community at the East York Town Centre, Monday to Friday, 9 to 5. Please come by and drop by and meet us, and we'd love to have a chat with you. So thank you for allowing us to borrow some additional time from your night to get to as many questions as possible. And I'll also remind folks that you can put questions into the Slido. We'll keep that open for a couple more days. So thank you, everyone, for your time this evening. We really appreciate you coming out and spending time with us, and we hope you have a good rest of your evening.